Susan. It's so good to have you here.
Thank you so much for having me, Barbara.
Greetings. As you can see, we're out in my backyard, relaxed. Chilling. This is my sister in silence, Susan Kelly Delaine. She's the owner of Hanok Zen Healing Arts. She is a Reiki master, and she also does a Korean-style tea service. And she is here today to talk with me about meditations. So welcome to Conversations About Meditation. Welcome, Susan.
Thank you very much.
Oh, I'm honored to have you here. Susan and I were talking about this. We met a few years ago. 3 years, maybe?
It's almost been 3 years. Yeah. Not quite.
Yeah, and we just laugh and say, we must have known each other in another life.
Yes, indeed.
So we're just going to dive on in. I want to find out how you got started with meditation.
Oh, boy. So meditation for me became a regular practice about 20 years ago. But I was always interested in it, even as a little girl.
Okay.
The reason I did not practice it or look very much into it as a little girl was because growing up in a Baptist background, in a Baptist home, I always assumed that meditation and Buddhism or meditation was connected to a specific religion. Once I grew up and found out that it does not necessarily have a specific tie or does not tie you to a religion, I felt, okay, I can delve deeper into this without the guilt and without any connection to any commitment.
Okay. So how did you move from meditating to doing sound? So listen, we do sound vibration with Susan. On Monday nights, we jokingly say that we sleep with Susan. It's about 20 of us that sleep with Susan. She does a Monday night raindrop, deep relaxation Reiki. How did you go from meditation to doing sound vibration in that area?
So, you know, meditation is by nature very reflective. Non-activity. I don't want to call it an activity.
Yeah.
And you reflect, you think on things, and you get what you've referred to as divine downloads. And so in my meditation, I get answers, I get revelations, I get I go through forgiveness.
But you travel.
I travel. We'll talk about that too, if you'd like. But one of the things that started to come to me was the ability to self-heal and to help other people along in their self-healing journey. And so as the years went on and I started a family, I had my first son, who I started practicing with as a little boy. And so I started doing Reiki treatments with him. And the natural progression of doing energy healing is learning other tools to pull into the energy healing process. So I started learning a little bit about crystals to pull in, started learning about sound healing and other different tools that you can use in the healing session to complement what you're trying to achieve. So,
okay,
yeah, it was just a natural progression and I love it.
Yes, we love that you love it and that you give us that gift every Monday night. So, you know, we are just coming out of lockdown, or lockup, or whatever you want to call it. So what would you say your meditation practice, were there any changes over the last year and a half because we were in a lockdown mode?
I actually became more consistent. I was actually able to tune into your meditations more frequently. And I found myself, of course, meditating more. We have more time on our hands, and it's just the thing that you do, self-care. But the thing that changed for me was during that process, I was reminded of one of my teachers. I also do what's called pranic healing, and my pranic healing teacher once told me, don't go into meditation with negativity, with a sense of urgency or a sense of needing. She said, before you go into meditation, try to release that. And she said to me, don't meditate as much. And I think what she meant was don't always go into meditation every time you're feeling distressed or every time or only when you're feeling a certain way.
Right.
Just make it a part of your daily practice. Go into it with a good mindset.
Yeah.
And so I was actually reminded of that during quarantine, because there was a lot of stressful moments.
Sure.
And there were a lot of worries and anxieties and uncertainties that I was saying, okay, well, I'm feeling it this way, I'm just going to sit down. And not knowing and or actually forgetting that when you do that, you're actually multiplying what you bring into meditation. So, so I would try to be mindful of that before I would go into meditation, especially during quarantine. And I try to keep on doing that now.
Oh, wonderful. So what's been a surprising aspect of meditation for you in terms of something that maybe you didn't think you would get from it, but find that it's been helpful with?
The less, this is in my case, the less you try, or the less hard you try, or the less effort you put into the meditating, the easier it is, and the more profound it gets. We joke all the time about my travels.
Yes. So Susan travels. When I do meditation on Wednesday night, Susan normally joins us. And if we do something where I'm talking about relaxing, she'll come back and she'll say, you know, I traveled. And I just love it because I go absolutely nowhere when I meditate. I don't see, I don't go anywhere, so I love to live vicariously through Susan's travels and all of the things she's experiencing.
Yeah, so the less I try, or the less intention I put into traveling, the more I travel. And so it just so happens on your Wednesday night, wind out, because it's been brought up so much, I'll go, okay, tonight I'm going to travel. And I never travel when I say I'm going to travel. But it is, it's been, it gets easier the more you do it, but easier the less effort you put into it. And it's, and there's not a way to it. You can meditate walking down the street. You can meditate climbing a tree. You can meditate cooking dinner. You can meditate while reading a book. You can meditate sitting still in nature. So there is not one way to do it. It's all about being observant and present.
Yes. So how did you move into doing your Korean silent teas? Because it's part of my, Susan is part of my self-care. Silence with Susan, sleeping with Susan on Monday nights. And then once a month you do. Tell us about your Korean silent tea practice.
Absolutely.
It is powerful.
Again, another product of meditation, to be honest with you. And I actually never thought about that, how that came about. Just the more mindful you become and the more you sit and contemplate on a regular basis, consistently, the more you get. And it literally just came to me as an activity to do with some friends and just to stay in touch with some friends. I invited some friends over. And I said, I want to do a Korean tea ceremony with you all. And while we're together, hey, let's draw. And hey, while we're together, let's eat. And let's have some time. But let's make this into a meditative event. And so it really was just out of the blue. But once we got together and I served the tea, and I told everyone, there's no talking involved. There's no talking allowed. And they kind of were
go
like,
over first?
Okay. They did well. Okay. They did well. Yeah. And I made a joke out of it. I put a big sign on the wall that said, no smiling, no laughing under any circumstances. And so that was kind of like, you got to keep it light. And it went so well. And they said, well, let's do this again. And about 3 months later, I did it again and kept inviting more and more people. And within, I would say, about 6 months, it became a thing.
Yeah.
And that's when I started putting it on Facebook and saying, hey, you know, we're having this event. And it started off in a friend's house and then moved into an official space in Fayetteville, Georgia, and grew from there. It's been a tradition. It's something that I recall very fondly doing with my grandmother, who I knew, she came from Seoul later in life to live with us. And so I met her for the first time when I was 18. And we would sit in silence. Because she did not speak English, so that was actually the reason why we're in silence. But I took it as more than just her inability to speak. Yeah. It was there was no coincidence there that we spent a lot of time in silence, communicating non-verbally, having coffee, having tea, using very few words, and just she would just hold my hands, and it was just an amazing exchange. And so I took that and developed it into something to offer to others. It's near and dear to me.
It's near and dear to me and others. So as we're coming to a conclusion with this conversation about meditation, what would you say to someone that was looking at meditating but didn't know where to start? What would you offer them as a way to check it out?
Come to Barbara Faison's 6:30 a.m. Monday through Friday meditation slice of silence on Facebook. Seriously.
Well, and Susan's family meditates with me on the weekend, so I think that is such a gift to me that her husband and her two sons, who are what, 19 and 20?
Well, 18 and 20.
They meditate with us on Sunday and Saturday at 8, 9 p.m. So that is a blessing to have a family that meditates, and then you meditate with me, and Justin will meditate with me on his own. So it is a gift to me that people will actually meditate with me, especially at 6:30.
Oh, we love it. You have no idea how many lives it has changed. But to answer your question, take it in any way that it comes to you. And there is no one way to do it. It's just, you know, you don't have to be in a lotus position. Yes. For hours. You don't have to be in nature. You don't have to be sitting still.
Yeah.
One of my favorite meditators, yogis, is actually Russell Simmons. Mm-hmm. And he once said, you can meditate anywhere.
Yeah.
You can meditate in the hood. You can meditate on the train. You can meditate walking down a busy street.
Yeah.
So it is what you make it. It's the intention behind it. And it's the intentional putting aside the time to do it that matters.
So as we're leaving our conversations about meditation, tell us how we can be in contact with you, your next upcoming event, so people can join, because all of those links will be below in the description. So please, 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 if you've never tried it, come and join us for Raindrop Reiki as well as the Silent Tea. I know you're not doing it in July.
That's right.
Right, because she's got a son going off to college. But other than a few times of the year, Susan is doing this and she is dedicated. So share with them where they can find out how to reach you.
Would love to have you, and all are welcome. Monday night, Raindrop Reiki is on Monday nights at 9:30 until 10:30, and that can be found on my link tree. The silent tea ceremonies are still virtual. We're going to be going live in person, hopefully by the end of the summer, but no promises.
Okay.
So that is also on my link tree, and you can follow my work, my posts, my inspirational information on Facebook and Instagram, which is Hanok Zen Healing Arts.
Spell that, please.
Hanok is H-A-N-O-K. It's a Korean word that means a traditional Korean house, which is built very simply and designed very simply, with no extra rooms, and has a specific plan of care as if you would care for yourself.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah, there's more to it. We'll talk about that one day.
Okay.
So Hanok is a Korean house.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anything else?
That's it.
All right. And she's wearing her beautiful Reiki necklace.
Yes.
Choku Ray. So thank you so much for joining us on this episode of Conversations About Meditation. If you are interested in being interviewed and you are a person who meditates, or even thinks you meditate, because as you said, we meditate all day long and we do things that are meditative, whether you're knitting, crocheting, swimming, walking, drinking coffee, drinking tea, all of those have traits of meditation. So feel free to reach out to me directly at my email address, which is Barbara Faison, that's F-A-I-S-O-N, LLC at Gmail, and just drop me a note and say I'm interested in conversations about meditation. We're out here now, as you can hear, the birds are in nature, and I've got something crawling on me because, well, we're in nature and we are in their habitat. But I thank you so much for joining, and remember to get out in Mother Nature if you can. And if you can, do it with a friend. Thanks for watching. Be well.